Now, we've got our very last hack, and that's all about how to scale and leverage your business. Because you can do property development as a side gig if you love your job, which is what we've spoken about. You can certainly just do one project on the side of your current job, or maybe one or two, or you can use it as your main business. So it's completely up to you. And either way, the process is the same. If you want to do one, you use the same philosophy around doing one project, or if you're going to do the four. It really comes down to leveraging your team and scaling yourself based on the access to others as well, to be honest with you. So, I want to share with you a couple of stories. So, firstly, I think I mentioned the story about my student in Victoria who has pulled together her first deal, and she's actually amalgamating two sites. And I think there's going to be four or five townhouses on this deal. Never done development before, ever. And she's really put this deal, she secured one site and then the other sites in the market. So she's done her numbers. She's done all the work in terms of understanding all the costs of different components. And this deal is, you know, over $500,000 for her very first deal, which is just amazing. So that very small investment that she's made in herself, do you reckon she's got a pretty good return on that? I think so. Would you be okay earning, you know, a decent six-figure sum? And that's still a small-scale development. That's the amazing thing. We're not talking massive high-rises here or 10-site projects. There's so much money to be made in property when you know what to look for and when you know the process to follow. So certainly on that. I just had a question around the bus tour as well. So there are six dates right now, so you can choose the dates. And certainly I know that, of course, there's a lot of border restrictions we're working with at the moment, so we'll work around that. So you won't miss the opportunity to, if you've secured a spot, we'll make sure you get an opportunity to come on board and share in that amazing experience as well. So thanks again for those who have joined. I can't wait to get to know you. So let's just talk around how to leverage and scale your business. So if we go forward now, I think what you'd be surprised, and it's funny when I was speaking to this student who I just mentioned a second ago, once she'd done it all and pulled the deal together, she went, what, is this it? Like, isn't there more to it? And that's the thing, like, once you actually understand the process, it's really quite straightforward. And it's just, you know, when you don't know what you don't know, that's when it seems really, really overwhelming. But when you understand the process and the bouncing ball to follow, then you go, oh, really? It's like Guy's testimonial when he said, I'm not busy enough, you know. Why am I not busy enough? I should be doing so much more. This project is going to earn me, you know, $2,000 an hour or more on his time invested. I should be busier, but it's not, because it's all about leverage. And then I think about, you know, think about this. I'm just going to run through some results now at the moment. So in the last 6 weeks, I've had three projects. I've cashed out of three projects. So I had a sixth project, the Dutton, my Raynell project, which we finished right when COVID hit, and I banked out of that, cashed out of that a couple of months ago, and then my Parkwood project, which I cashed out of about 3 weeks ago now, and all of those projects added up together are over $600,000 in profit. And then, you know, if we move to the next slide, this is what I've got in the pipeline right now. So I've got my Melville project, which if you come on the bus tour, I'm going to take you actually on this site. And you may have seen in the Rising Star Developer Tribe, I've put together a journey video about right from when I secured the site to when I got through planning and the working drawing side of things and the sales side of things and construction, and you actually now get to walk through a site where actually I've done the lower frame. So what I do with my inner circle members is actually show them where I'm at with my projects as well. So we did the lower frame and the cladding. We had an awesome discussion in the group around the materials that I used for this project, and you know, we had we're talking around Hebel and the benefits of Hebel and versus brick, and you know, even though I'm not a builder, I understand it from a development perspective. And then so they're the sort of things that go on inside the group. So I've got my Melville project, which is five houses under construction right now. I've got my Phillip project, which is three row dwellings. So I only purchased this site about 6-7 weeks ago. I purchased this site. I got my planning approval on this one on Thursday, which is amazing. So I'm now ready. I've actually handed over on the site. I set her on the site the end of September. So yeah, about 2 weeks ago. So I got my approval. I got it in and out of council in 5 weeks, which is just amazing. And I'm working very closely with the builder on this one. So I'm going to get the house demolished in the next few weeks, and then we'll get the working drawings sorted out and aim to start construction of these ones here in January. And these are only three single storeys, so I'll be out of this project in June. So that'll be less than 12 months from when I actually bought the site to when I get out of this site. So these are affordable homes, three bedrooms, two bathrooms, and there's a six-figure profit associated with these. I think this is about 150, 160K for this deal. And then I also bought another one 2 weeks after I bought the Phillip. And that's another three-row dwelling site, three single-storey row dwellings, three bedrooms, two bathrooms, single garage. You can see a formula here that I use. And as you know, I try to keep things simple. I use a formula and I just rinse and repeat it. Why complicate it? If something's working and it's not broken, why try and fix it? So that's the site that's actually in council at the moment. That will be the same timelines. I haven't actually settled on that one yet. I settled on that one the end of November, but I'm already in council. I should be out of council and have my working drawings and my building rules consent by the end of the year, ready to start construction, the same timeline as my Phillip project. So I should be out of that maybe a month later, probably July, another six-figure sum. So, and then I'll start looking for some more deals as well. So I've got generally 3 to 6 deals going on at any one time at various stages. And the time it takes me probably, I reckon, and this is not, you know, this is not playing it up here, I'm probably spending about an hour a week, maybe two. Maximum a week, and that's making a quick phone call to council, how's my planning going, making a quick call to a builder, and making a quick call, I'm working on the sales strategy for these projects in the background. That's probably taking most of my time. Once I'll go live with my Phillip project next week, because I don't generally list my projects until I've got planning approval, so I'll go live with that. But yeah, look, I really don't spend a lot of time, because I'm also doing this Rising Star business, and you know, I'm spending a lot of time and energy with that as well. And so that's the amazing thing about this business. It does not take too much of your time. So if I can't impress, when you're learning and looking for deals, that does take more time. And I set myself some parameters to try and condense that time. And so that's why I'll say, you know, crunch 5 deals a day. When I've done those 5 deals, then I move on to the next thing. So that's probably the most time-consuming part of property development. Also, when you hand over a project, when you're on site, just to make sure that everything's all okay, that can be, you know, maybe a couple of hours, maybe 3 hours a week, 4 hours a week max. But yeah, overall, I mean, there's some, with my Armstrong project, I probably haven't spent any time on that at all for the last 2 weeks while it's been in council. So just to give you a bit of insight in terms of the time that I spend. So how do you scale? Like, how do you get to, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 projects? Let me share that with you. You scale by leveraging. And you would have heard this word over and over throughout the day. Leverage your time. You know, you leverage money. And you leverage skill. They're the three things. And they apply to life as well. But, you know, in terms of this business, they're the three things that enable me to scale my business. And it'll be the same thing for you as well. So in terms of leveraging time, how do you leverage time? First thing, keep it simple. You can complicate property development, but why? Because it doesn't change the outcome. So as you know, I've got a process, like a good example here is I've got my Phillip and my Armstrong projects. I'm using the same specification document for the both of them. I may have tweaked a couple of external paint colours for those, but they're exactly the same. So you know what? It takes me 2 minutes to change the name from 10 Phillip to 12 Armstrong. Same document. So it looks impressive, a spec document that I'll use for my sales. That's it, my sales strategy. I've gone and got some renders, but I'm using the same sales strategy for both of them. I mean, why complicate it? Just, you know, rinsing and repeating, that is what I do. So you start to see a trend. Like if you saw my earlier projects, did you see the trend there? I was doing two-storey townhouses and I saw quite a few of them. And then the numbers changed. And then you can see what I'm doing now. I'm doing, you know, street frontage row dwellings, and I'm just doing the same thing in different areas, you know, similar areas, and using the model. And you know the numbers so well. It's just, you know, keeping it simple and rinsing and repeating. And then, you know, you build your team. So we spoke about this very early on in Hack 2. Like, once you've built your team around you, what I do now is a new project. So when my new projects came up, I went, call my designer. Hey, we're going to do this. And I'll send an email, this is what I want. And they pretty much know anyway, because they're the same sort of formula. This is what I want. There you go. Off you go, design. Conveyancer, can you set up my sales contracts? This is what I'm purchasing. Create the new entity. Off you go. Sales, this is what I'm planning to do. This is my strategy. Off you go. Finance, Tom, you know, here's the deal. Here's the parameters. Off you go. Organising the finance. It doesn't take very long because you've got that team around you. They all know how you work. You know, you look after each other because they know the way you operate and they know, you know, your values and that you're good to work with and you're fair. And does that mean that I don't pull up people if they don't do the right thing? Not at all. If someone, you know, doesn't deliver a time frame or, you know, stuffs up something, I'll call it out. But I always call it and I do everything with kindness. So, you know, I'll call up and say, come on, guys, that's just not good enough. You know, I expect X, Y, Z. And you can still do that and get the same result without, you know, flying off the deep end and, you know, breaking a relationship. You do it with kindness, but you're still stern and you get the message across and you're clear about what your expectations are up front so that people, when people know where they stand and what is expected of them, you know, it makes it a lot easier for them to try and meet that expectation. But if you're really airy-fairy and you go, yeah, you know, I wouldn't mind this or I wouldn't mind that, and you don't communicate what you're expecting, then that's where communication breaks down and you don't get what you want and you can things get frustrated. So, yeah, building your team, you build it once and you generally use that team, and then if you need to tweak, make a few tweaks, you can do that too. So that's really leveraging, you know, leveraging your time. And leveraging money. So, you know, that's through using money partners. So as you know, I don't use any of my own money. I leverage money partners. So when I got my Philip deal, when I found that one, I got on the phone and I spoke to 2 or 3 money partners. And I said, okay, look, you're cashing out of this deal. And also my investors get out of a deal, I'll always ask them, and it's a conversation I have with Andrew as well, whenever we finish a project, okay, you know, where are you at? Do you want to go again? And what funds do you have available to go again, and what's your expectations? Same with my money partners. I'll go, you know, where are you at? You know, you've got 20,000, 100,000, 200,000. You know, where are you at? Do you want to go again? Do you want to invest? I've got a project coming up. And then my returns may vary depending on the type of project that I've got. So, you know, I was offering 20% return of my money for these projects that had a lot of profit in them. These ones here have less profit, but I get in and out faster, so I don't offer as high a return. So I'll call them up and say, look, you know, the return's a bit lower, but you're going to get your money back faster. So your actual cash on cash return over the time period is not going to be too different. So, so you know, once you've got your money partners and your joint venture partners and they've been through the journey, you know, it's quick to... So I basically had my Philip project funded in 10 minutes through 2 phone calls. Are you interested? Yep, awesome, lock you in, you're done. Are you interested? Yep, okay, you're locked in, you're done. And then I created a loan agreement, sent it off, my funding was secured. I mean, you know, that's where things get really, really simple. And it's all built on relationships and it's all built on open and honest and transparent communication. So they know that, you know, you've given the money back, you know, even when I'm with my money partners, I communicate with everyone monthly. So I give them an update on the project monthly so people know how things are progressing. And if things are slow, I'll let them know the timing. And once again, open and honest communication so everyone knows where they stand. And that also builds trust in you and in the project and the way that you run your business too. So leveraging money, banks, absolutely. So, you know, as you do more projects, you know, the banks get used to you as well, and they understand the way that you work. And I've, you know, through Tom, I've got some amazing relationships with banks who understand the way that I do things, and I communicate openly and honestly with them and let them know when I'm cashing out of a project. And Tom certainly and his team help me facilitate that. And then at the same time, they're also always, they understand my business, so they're also looking for other funding partners that might meet the way that I do, you know, my funding requirements going forward. So so as soon as I'm looking for a deal, as soon as I've got a deal, I'm on the phone. Tom, I've got this coming up, X, Y, Z, and then we're away. So yeah, leveraging money is the key to be able to fund your deals. Now, if you don't have access to money, or you don't have access to time or access to skill, then you find that skill or that money or that time to be able to bring the deal together. So leveraging skill, you know, your A-team is critical, and I touched on the key A-team that you need back in that in the second hack around, you know, building your team, and that is amazing. You leverage their skill because, you know, I did actually contemplate doing a building becoming a builder myself, and I thought, what am I thinking? Why would I become a builder? What builders do is amazing and they're good at it, but that's not me, that's not my strength. So let me get the people who are good at what they do, the guys that get building and get the old detail and are good at managing trades. And I mean, the builders, my goodness, they earn their money. That, you know, managing all the, you know, you think about what goes into a home, all the different components that they have to manage to be able to create this home, and all the multiple trades that they have to manage. I mean, they deserve the margin they get. And so yes, if you wanted to be the builder and the sales agent, and do it all yourself, yeah, you could earn extra commission. But do you reckon you're going to have that time? Do you reckon it's going to be a lifestyle business if you're trying to manage all the trades and manage the building and manage the sales side of it and take the calls and purchases? I mean, you're actually creating yourself a job. You're not creating yourself a business where you work on it as opposed to in it. And that's really, really key, because if you're too busy managing the details of a project, you can't leverage scale and scale and keep doing more projects, because you're going to run out of time or you're going to run out of money. So leverage, definitely leverage skill. Leverage your project managers. If you're feeling like you're not confident to run your first project, go and find a project manager that knows how to do it, or go and find, you know, an educator, or, you know, the program that I teach. You know, you learn your project management skills there. Actually, I'm not sure if Joe's on the call on this session today, but one of my students, she had just finished a project, and she just secured her next deal last weekend at auction, and I was telling her some of my branding strategies, or, you know, all my community, telling them branding strategies with how I brand my projects, and she did the same thing. And then she sent me a message, went, oh my god, someone's driven past and they've actually asked me to project manage their deal. She goes, I can't believe it. She said, oh, I'm really nervous. What do I do? And I said, don't be nervous. You know what? You apply the same principles to what you're doing in your projects to somebody else, because even though you're all new to this, you've learned, you've been educated about the process. So you actually know far more than they know, because they haven't even been educated on it. So even though you're learning and you're doing your first project, you still know more than someone who's never actually had support or been educated. So that's a really important thing. So yeah, project manager, you don't have to be a really super experienced project manager. You just need to understand the process and then apply that process to either your own project or to the project of others. And that's also another cash flow angle. So one thing I haven't mentioned out of all this, you can earn funds through doing your own developments, but you can also do site finding. So so the deal that the testimonial that I showed you with Guy, I actually found that deal and flicked it onto him because I couldn't take on that deal at that point in time. And I got a 10K from that. So that was 3 phone calls. So I found the deal, did the numbers quickly, rang up Guy, said, are you interested? He said, yeah, hell yeah. And I got 10K for it. So also within the community, I teach people around doing that as well, finding deals. If people are too busy and they can't find deals, get somebody else to find a deal for them and pay them for it. You know, and that's another way of creating cash flow. So deal finding, doing some project management, or doing your own deal. So once you understand the process, there's a number of different ways that you can get cash flow from that, which is amazing. And yeah, leveraging education. So that is key. It really is key to, I mean, yes, you can go out there and Google it and try and fumble your way through, but learning something and learning some shortcut, one shortcut can pay itself off tenfold when it comes to doing your own development. So if you're worried about, you know, the cost involved in doing an education, you know, that's going to pay. You know, if you earn a 6-figure profit, or even if, you know, you find a site and flick it on for 10K, you almost doubled your return already. So do you see what I mean? Like, once you actually know the process, and you know, you're going to pay that return off really, really quickly. So and I think of, you know, I think this is a great quote here, like, think of property development like a puzzle. So if you don't have money, go find somebody who does. If you don't have access to serviceability or debt, go find a partner that does. If you don't have the skill, but you've got the money, go find someone that does. Actually, a quick story. I'm conscious of time here because I know it's been a long day, but I'm not sure if you're still on here, Samantha, but I had this one-on-one call with one of my new students, and oh my God, I came out of that session completely blown away by this woman. So she's running her, you know, her family business. She's 26 years old, and financially, she's sorted. But because of where she's at, she does a lot of volunteer work for underprivileged youth and wants to learn how to do property development to be of service and to create homes for underprivileged youth. And, you know, to be able to do that, I mean, the fact that she's 26 and even thinking about that is so admirable. But there's so many different ways that you can apply what you've learnt to whatever connects with you and your purpose in life. I got off that call with Samantha and I felt so inspired to think, oh my God, firstly, you know, what an amazing woman you are, but the fact that you're using this whole process, the whole business process, to be of service to others is just amazing. She's the missing piece of the puzzle that she had was to be able to understand the process of development, and she's also a really busy lady, so you know, she's happy to also be a joint, you know, to provide a money partner and somebody else do the legwork as well. So that's the sort of caliber of people we have in the community, which I'm really, really proud. So really, we've spoken around development as a puzzle, so leveraging skill, leveraging time, and leveraging really is the key to scale. You might have mentioned my husband's view, leverage is the key in all aspects of life, because you know, when you're starting up a new business, you've got to make sure you keep everything in perspective, leverage your life, and you don't have to do everything yourself. And leverage family members, leverage your partners, you know, as you're going through this learning stage and this property development journey, don't be afraid to ask other people to help you, so that you can get to where you want to get to as quickly as possible. So leverage, I can't say that enough. So because also it really is, it is, you know, education and leverage really breeds confidence as well, and that's when, you know, confidence breeds confidence. So that's probably a key part of that.